Hello everyone, welcome to Liverpool. I have the greatest pleasure in introducing Dr. Dan Hawker today, and he is a senior lecturer in pediatric clinical pharmacology and has an interest and is involved in pharmacogenomic research in the University of Liverpool and has an honorary contract as a consultant pediatrician here at Alderhey. Dan, over to you.
Thank you, Amy. And thank you for inviting me. I'm here to talk today about personalising medicines for children. So essentially, how to get the best, safest medicines possible. And what I hope to talk about is, first of all, let's just define what we're talking about, because there are lots of terms. Some are used interchangeably, some are used plain wrong, and it's useful just to get everybody onto the same page. And then I probably need to defend why we would think about children with pharmacogenomic research anyway, because your DNA doesn't change from when you're born to when you die, unless you get cancer or something. So why do we care about children particularly? And I hope I can persuade you that there's a particular scientific rationale, but also clinical need for it. We're going to touch on when pharmacogenetics or pharmacogenomics is completely useless, because actually sometimes it is. We're going to touch about how genes then could affect medicines and therefore work into when you might not think it's useless, but when it might actually have some function. Where are we then? What's the state of the art? How would you know if you were getting the best, you know, pharmacogenomic information and advice? And clearly this is an evolving area. How can we improve? How can we get this thoroughly embedded into practice and make the world a better place? So that's the goal. I suppose you'll have to tell me if you think we get there. Okay, so we're going to start really simple and think about history. So things have changed, evolved. If you think about the disease, first of all, you know, it's no longer spirits and possession. It's no longer descriptions of symptoms. It's now a molecular pathological understanding of many illnesses, and it's heading towards that way with a lot of others. Now, there's a lot of advantages to that. If we understand the molecular underpinnings of an illness, we can design drugs to treat it. However, it does mean we have in pediatrics an awful lot more diseases where we used to have just one. So yes, that is helpful, and from a pharmacogenomics point of view, almost essential, but it's not an uncaveated success. Okay. The second thing we've looked at differently is the patient. So if you are trephining people in a cave as a caveman, you don't really consider the patient, you just do it because that's what you do, because you've got spirits. Then we start to look at, you know, Galen, and really not a lot has changed since then in terms of history taking. So we ask for information that will help us discriminate one patient from another and help us to put them into categories that we can then determine which treatment is best for. And, you know, okay, we don't ask smokers so much in pediatrics, but age, weight, what else is wrong with them? Are they allergic to anything? Are they on any other medicines? Have they tried this medicine before? Simple things with the patient that we can use to distinguish, again, what the relative benefits of a treatment are and what the risks would be. But moving forwards, and this is one of the cusps that we're moving over, is to something called deep phenotyping. So this would be a much deeper understanding, and you can do this in a number of ways. So it might be that you link databases together, and actually it isn't a question of people, say, going to different hospitals and getting advice from three different specialists, because actually all the hospitals should be able to talk to each other, and you should know if you're seeing it, I'm in Alderhey, if I'm seeing a patient here in Alderhey, if they've been seen in Blackpool, Burnley, Bury and Bognor Regis beforehand. That should be something new. But you can also look at the patient, not just where they've been, but how the patient is built. So their DNA, do they have any polymorphisms? How would that therefore have an effect on treatment? And that's one of the aspects we're going to feature quite heavily in this. And the third sort of evolution of change is around medicines, or drugs, I've called them here. Clearly, we used to, you know, bark of a willow tree gives them aspirin, then aspirin is a pain reliever, you synthesize aspirin and you make tablets with the same amount in each. Symptom focus, you've got pain, you take some aspirin. Now, you only give aspirin to children with very limited conditions, Kawasaki's disease, or who need post-op cardiac surgery, who need aspirin for anti-blood clot, anti-platelet reasons. So optimized individual benefit risk, because there are other better non-steroidals that exist for treating pain, but there is still a case for that particular drug. So how we view drugs has also changed. And this talk will really focus on where those three things come together. So where we have an understanding of the molecular pathology of a disease, where we have deep phenotype information of a patient, and therefore where we're optimizing drugs for risk and benefit. Now, terminology. This is a slightly dull bit, and I'm sorry, but if we don't all agree what we're talking about, then we're all talking about something different. So if you're a student or you're talking and you're trying to sound knowledgeable and you've got a choice, do you call it pharmacogenetics? Do you call it pharmacogenomics? Well, I would always go with pharmacogenomics because pharmacogenetics has a very precise meaning. Pharmacogenetics is where there are changes in somebody's genetic code that changes how they respond to a medicine, either good or bad. Okay? And it's not a new concept. You can see it's been around for, 55, 60 years. Pharmacogenomics takes the concept that actually you can have differences that are not just in your genetic code that will affect the protein expressed through transcription, translation, epigenetic changes. And I've got a figure later on in my presentation that covers the epigenome, the metabolome, the proteome, all those other omic things, they all fall into pharmacogenomics. If you're not sure, go with pharmacogenomics. There's also a load of terms that basically relate to applying pharmacogenomics into practice. And they boil down, and I've lifted definitions from various, from a publication that sought to unravel this online. It was one of the densest reads I've had in years, this, because it was a very, very, very detailed look at the linguistics behind it. Essentially, personalization is trying to get the best medicine for an individual in front of you. Stratification is trying to get a group of people, small group, and identify which groups would benefit. And precision is kind of an overview that covers both of those ideas. So, my view, and I like a picture, is I put it like this. Personalized medicine, it's not personal medicine. You're never going to get a medicine that is only suitable for one person and nobody else. Okay, that's even if you're Bill Gates or the Amazon guy, Bezos, you're never going to have a medicine that's just for you. But there will be medicines who are only suitable for a small proportion of the population. And personalized medicine is trying to identify the individuals within those small groups who would benefit from it. Stratified medicine is a similar concept, but it's I view it as putting people in sort of slightly thicker strata, like you would see with sedimentary rocks, where you see the slightly thicker bands running across. So you've got slightly bigger groups, and they are all part of the precision medicine continuum or world. And it took me so long to make this picture last night. I mean, I'm irrationally proud of it. But anyway, pharmacogenetics and pharmacogenomics feed into this. If you don't know what makes individuals different and makes groups of people different, you can't run a precision medicine. You can run it to a certain extent, but you can't run it to its full potential. Okay? And the goal of it all is to maximize the benefit-risk ratio for individual patients. And I've got a nice figure coming up in a minute that will break this down again in visual form. But then you've got to think how this is fitting into health services. So pharmacogenetics and pharmacogenomics are tools. And the tools are to be able to deliver your healthcare goal, which is precision medicine. And the result of that should be that you're getting better outcomes, so improved efficacy and reduced risk. That's the goal. Right. So what does that look like in real life? Well, at the moment, if I have, and I don't know how many people are in this figure, I probably should count it one day. I'll call it 50. There's a group of people, and they're not coloured as they are, but they all look the same when they turn up. They've all got the same diagnosis, and we're all going to give them the same prescription. Okay? Now, for some patients who should be green but are white, the drug does good, so it makes them feel better, so it's beneficial, and it doesn't make them poorly. Excellent. They're the group you want to get the medicine in all situations. Okay? If you've got a disease worth treating, then and you've got access to a medicine that can treat it, and it's not going to do any harm, and it will do some good, they should be selected for treatment. I don't think anybody would argue with that. Okay? There's a second group who I think should be yellow, but are green in this figure. But anyway, they're people who get benefit from the drug, but also experience toxicity. Now, this is where it gets a bit more nuanced, because it depends what you're treating, really. if you're treating the common cold, then you absolutely will not accept drug toxicity because it's a transient illness that wears off in a short period of time and doesn't cause any lasting harm. However, if you're treating cancer, then of course you're going to put up with some toxicity because otherwise the disease is going to kill you. So you have to contextualize whether it's worth giving the drug in the first place and are the risks acceptable in the context of the benefits you're going to get. There are a group of patients in whom the drug does absolutely nothing. Okay, it doesn't work, make them better, doesn't make them poorly either. There's a serious question amongst this group of did they take the medicine? Okay, adherence is really, really, really hard to measure. And patients tell doctors all the time, yes, they take the medicine. And the moment we try and measure it, you can see, oh no, they don't. Okay, and no matter what, the science of adherence is talk in itself. But it's fascinating. If you give people inhalers with counters on them so that you can measure every time they take an inhale in one of their inhalations, then they will spray the inhaler around the room rather than take it, but then tell the doctor they've taken it. It's a complex area and a massive amount of psychology and understanding of human behaviours and people's tolerance of risk and benefit. Okay, so but they probably shouldn't get the drug if they're taking it, but it doesn't do anything, because it's a waste of everyone's time and effort, in all honesty. And the last group are the ones that should absolutely not get the drug, and they are appropriately coloured red. They're the ones who it's toxic, but it doesn't do any good. Okay? Now, if we could pull those groups apart, identify them before we prescribe the medicine, and adjust our prescribing habits appropriately, that is pharmacogenomics in a nutshell. And it started way back with a now defunct antihypertensive medicine, which was never used in kids and never really used in adults. The drug was called dibrisiquin, and it was put in some clinical trials, and in some of the patients, their blood pressure went down when they first took the drug, and most people came back up again a short time later and everything was fine. And in a few individuals, the blood pressure stayed low for ages. Many, many, many hours, several days, low blood pressure. And the reason that came about was that this particular drug was metabolized by one of the liver enzymes, a phase one metabolizing enzyme called cytochrome P450-2D6, or shortening it called CYP, CYP2D6. And in this population who didn't recover their blood pressure, the drug was hanging around for ages because they weren't metabolizing it. Okay, and the reason was that their CYP2D6, the metabolizing enzyme in their liver, didn't work. And the reason it didn't work was because there was one change in the genetic code in amino acid 169, which meant that instead of reading GGA, the trinucleotide block that should have produced a glycine in the amino acid change, the G swapped to a T, and that produced a stop codon. The protein is too short, it doesn't fold up properly, it doesn't do its job, and they couldn't break down the drug, which meant that it lasted in their body for ages. Okay, and CYP2D6 is like the rock star, if you can have such a thing, of pharmacology, cytochrome P450 enzymes. It's everywhere, and it's a pain in the neck. Okay, since then, and we've moved beyond just the pink box at the top, these genetic variants, and pharmacogenomics also considers things like a transcriptome, the proteins that are there, metabolomes, and there are, I'm sure you've read or heard phrases around multi-omics platforms that teach to examine all of these things. That's all true, and that all happens, but it's all downstream of understanding that if your genes change, or the product of your genes change, your response to drugs can change. Since then, we've learned some more. I'm going to focus on CYP2D6 for a minute, just to, so that you can understand the, how well characterized some of the science in this area is. So if you're dealing with drug metabolizing enzymes, for instance, they're an obvious place to start, because you would look at the molecules that help transport drugs, help break down drugs, in terms of ones that would change how well drugs work. And beyond that one example of a non-functional prematurely terminated CYP2D6, people have found lots and lots and lots of other versions of CYP2D6. So there are, and they're generally characterized, you write CYP2D6, you put a star and then you can have a number afterwards. And the different numbers are different genetic code that is within the gene compared to the normal. So star one is your normal one, is your wild type, is the one that most people have. Okay, there are other ones that work, star two, star 35. There are ones, there are some people who have more than one copy of more than one working gene, so they make extra, and that's the green box at the top. There are some people who have a version that it's not perfect, but does a job, it's all right. They're the low functional alleles. And there's some people who have a non-functional version. Now remember that you get two genes, one from each parent. So just because you've got a non-functional on one doesn't mean you're going to have a non-functional on the other. So you will have a spectrum of activity between Joe Average, who will have two functional genes, one from each parent, two functional alleles, I should say technically, one from each parent, to somebody who might have a very rare case of four, two from each parent, duplicated alleles, and will be an extremely rapid metabolizer, versus somebody who's very unlucky and gets two non-functional versions and finds it very hard to metabolize these drugs at all. Okay, and this is shown here in a sort of visual format. So on the left-hand side, the UMs are ultra-rapid metabolizers. They're the people who've got multiple copies on at least one arm of, from at least one parent, and they're shown there by the two blue rectangles on the line next to one blue rectangle. Okay, the middle, the second column is EM, extensive metabolizers. I think this should be called like wild type, but extensive metabolizer is your Joe Public. They've got two standard working copies of the CYP2D6 gene. IMs are intermediate metabolizers, so they have one that works and one that doesn't. And PM is poor metabolizer. They don't have any functional copies, okay? And the graphical representation of the concentration time graphs is sort of showing a identical dose given by an identical route and what happens. And if you are an extensive metabolizer, so the second column along, the gray horizontal bar represents the therapeutic zone where you would expect the drug to do some good. So if you take a standard dose and you've got standard drug metabolizing enzymes, then you'll have a period of time in the therapeutic zone, therapeutic concentration, and therefore you would expect some good to come. If you're an ultra-rapid metabolizer, you may never reach that concentration. It may get whizzed through your system far faster than you can ever build up to get any benefit from it. If you're an intermediate metabolizer, you may not reach the therapeutic zone for ages because it may be that you build up concentrations, it just doesn't get metabolized quickly enough to keep you in the zone you need for a long time. And the poor metabolizers, well, they can get really poorly. And beneath that, you can then see how this relates to response to this treatment in terms of lack of response, an expected response, an exaggerated response, or perhaps even adverse events. These would be type A adverse drug reactions, so based on the known pharmacology of the drug. And if you're thinking about the antihypertensive example I gave earlier, then you would expect somebody's blood pressure to either drop more than you expect or to stay down for much longer because you can't get rid of it, rather than suddenly developing Stevens-Johnson syndrome or something, because this is all related to concentrations of the drug around the receptors and their usual function. Okay, fine, that's nice, but it's CYP2D6, that was all a long time ago, and really, is it going to bother me? Well, this is a global talk, and we could have people listening from anywhere, and depending where you're listening from, you will have different rates of poor, intermediate, extensive, and ultra-rapid metabolizers in CYP2D6. For the population of Liverpool, where I happen to be, predominantly Caucasian population, around 6 to 10% of people are poor metabolizers. However, if you are from certain regions of Ethiopia, up to 1 in 3 people can be an ultra rapid metabolizer. So there may well need to be dosing differences or consideration, or at least you need to think carefully about which drugs are appropriate depending on who you're going to give it to, because different ancestries will have different rates of drug either poor effectiveness or adverse events. And this is not just an adult problem. I feel I should, you know, start to bring the pediatrics in here, okay? This is a case report from a while ago now in The Lancet, but this was a really unfortunate mother who breastfed her baby, receive codeine, which is a metabolite of CYP2D6, and it doesn't work unless it's metabolized by CYP2D6 into morphine. Okay? Codeine itself is a prodrug and it doesn't relieve pain. So if we just go back for a second and look at our numbers here, we would expect 6 to 10% of the population we serve in Liverpool here not to get any analgesia if we give them codeine. On the other hand, if you are an Ethiopian or Saudi descent, then you may well get a much more effective conversion of codeine into morphine, and you may get additional analgesic effects. But if it gets too high, you may get respiratory depression or the adverse effects of opiates. And that's exactly what happened to this poor baby. It was being breastfed. Mum had codeine for, I believe, a cesarean section, episiotomy and cesarean section. Yes, it says on the page there. And the poor old baby got overdosed with morphine excreted in breast milk and died of a respiratory arrest. Now, that's a tragedy and has been the lever for certainly locally and nationally in the UK, codeine being moved away from as a postnatal analgesia. I believe it's supposed to change internationally, but that's not, not 100% confident on that, but I'm pretty sure it has. So pharmacogenomics can and does affect how we treat children. Okay, but that's one drug. Do we really care? Well, just CYP2D6 is responsible for about a quarter of all medicines in terms of it has the metabolism of that medicine is wholly or partly undertaken by cytochrome P450-2D6. And these aren't, just, your adult medicines that we don't care about. You know, ADHD medicines, antidepressants, analgesia, anti-cancer agents, they're on this list, which is not exhaustive, but it certainly starts to give you an idea of the number of drugs that are substrates for CYP2D6. Okay, so this is just one enzyme and one set of drugs, but you can see how ubiquitous it can be. Okay, now, as I said earlier, clearly when you start to look at the drugs that are involved in the metabolism of, the enzymes and the genes that are involved in metabolism and the transport of drugs, you've got a very rich scene to look at in terms of could variations within them change how well drugs work. And this list here is of ones that are believed and have evidence supporting the fact that when their variations within them can change either the safety or efficacy of the drug in question. And some of these are really common. G6PD is the most common genetic polymorphism affecting drugs that we have. And there's a whole load of drugs that shouldn't be, whose use should be cautioned because of hemolysis with G6PD deficiency. Others are rarer. So there are changes in HLA antigens that can affect carbamazepine and increase your risk of SJS and toxic epidermal necrolysis. But they're well described and they're well understood, the theoretical risks behind them. Okay, now that's all well and good. I hope I've persuaded you now that genes affect drugs, and if we understand differences in genes, then we might understand differences in drugs. The next question is making it pediatric. So here is a guy I found on Google Images. Here is an old lady I found on Google Images. And this one's my son, because I felt a bit wrong Googling like children's pictures. So that's Robin anyway, in his Robin t-shirt. Spot the difference. I mean, apart from size, I mean, she's probably slightly taller than him, but people change across their lifespan, okay? But their DNA is the same. So why should I come on here and tell you that we should consider children in pharmacogenomic research, because actually their DNA is exactly the same as the 35-year-old guy in the middle and probably the same as Esther the granny on the right-hand side? Well, the reason is that just because the code is the same doesn't mean that you turn on and turn off the genes or express them at the same frequency at different ages of life, okay? And I'll show this through a picture here, because I love a picture. So this is a figure showing a hypothetical gene, and the ages are on the x-axis. Okay, so when you get to 25, the guy in the middle of that last picture, then there's one individual who seems to have really quite a high level of expression, a group of people who express quite a lot in the middle, and a small number who don't make very much at all at the bottom. Okay, but if you trace the lines back, then at 10 and at birth, they're expressing very different amounts. And if you plot those separately, so you've got your poor expressors or your low expressors in red and the rest in blue, you can see that as you get closer to birth, then actually it's harder and harder to tell the difference. And actually there must be other pathways involved in the very young that are differentiating or metabolizing the drugs that are coming in at that point. If it's a drug metabolizing enzyme or handling it and transporting it differently, if it's a transport enzyme or something else. And the second thing at age 10 is that, yes, you're starting to see, in this hypothetical example, a group of low expressors, but the average amount of expression is actually much higher than in an adult. Okay, so you're not able to differentiate into the three groups as an adult. Actually, it's two very different groups, and the average amount of expression of this particular protein is much higher. So expression changes with age, and that's why we need to look at the genetics of children separately. And we can show you that the phrase is ontogeny for describing the change in expression with age. So this is a graph showing expression of something called cytochrome P453A7. Okay, you probably won't have heard of it because you don't have a lot of it after you're born. But if you're born prematurely and you're on a neonatal unit, you probably have a lot of it. Okay, but it goes down, and after you're born, cytochrome P453A4 goes up. So there are prenatal and postnatal changes that drive down the expression of 307. Even though you have the genetics for it your whole life, you just don't express very much after you're born. Whereas CYP3A4, you don't express very much in utero or as a premature baby who's come out too early. But after you've after you're born, over about the first year, you build up to about 80% of your expected amounts of CYP3A4. And CYP3A4 is a really common drug metabolizing enzyme. Okay, if CYP2D6 does about a quarter of all medicines, CYP3A4 has a role in over half of the medicines that are prescribed. Okay. CYP2D6 is the same. So not only does CYP2D6 have variations within its genetic code that mean that it may or may not work, or you may have more than one copy, but it also varies in expression with age. So the younger you are, the less you express. Even if you're an ultra rapid metabolizer, even if you make tons of the stuff, then you don't get very much of it. And people have actually done research studies looking at the generation of metabolites of drugs that are CYP2D6 substrates, and showing that you can plot increased metabolite development, which is the right-hand side graph, or against postmenstrual age. The drug in question in this particular study was tramadol, and I've yet to understand why anybody gave premature babies tramadol, but they've done it. Here's the science, and at least it backs up the idea that you get different levels of expression at different ages. Okay. The final point, just to hammer this home, is that I've talked very much about pharmacokinetic enzymes. So one's how the body affects the drug, metabolizing enzymes, transporters. Other transporters, that there are transporters on the cell surface that can extrude drugs or help drugs pass into the thing. One of the ones that helps extrude drugs from cells is the ABCB1 transporters. Okay, this has a particularly interesting change in expression over time. In the youngest children, there are three box whisker plots and next to each other at the bottom, and they show three different, each box whisker plot, each box at the bottom shows three different variations. So it shows one that is CC, so the individual is homozygous, they have the same genetic code, and they have a C at a particular point in the polymorphism. The middle one, CT, are heterozygous, so they've got one C copy and one T copy from each parent. And the right-hand side one on each graph is the double T, so that's the individuals who got two T copies, one from each parent. Okay, so there's slight three populations, all the same C, one of each, all the same T. And they are expressed at different rates depending on the polymorphism. Okay, which means that you will extrude cyclosporine from cells at different rates, at different ages, because your different polymorphisms are expressed differently at different ages. See, it gets proper complicated sometimes. Right, if you're going to make all that simple, genetic factors affect the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics of a drug. They both affect how the drug responds, and they're what gives you the individual efficacy and toxicity. So if we understand the genetic factors, we will go a long way to harmonizing drug response between individuals and improving the efficacy to the maximum we can. No drug is 100% effective, and reducing the toxicity as far as we can. But no drug will have no side effects. Okay. So it's important, it's really important. It's the best thing since sliced bread. We should do it all the time. No, no, just let's go and order some genetic tests. Well, yeah, but let's be honest, some of the time it's completely irrelevant. And I'm sure you can all think of your own example, but I think of the baby who's vomiting. If you bring a 3-month baby in, they're feeding, they're growing, they're vomiting, there's no bile, they're developing normally. What are we talking about? You know, it's probably overfeeding, but if it isn't overfeeding, it's probably reflux, whatever that is. If you're going to treat that, then your first port of call is going to be a thickener. So an alginate or Gaviscon, there are other brands available. There's only one option, there's only one dose, and there's only one single adverse effect of note. And it's very rapid on off. So if they get constipated, you just stop it and the constipation goes away. Yeah. There is no need to genotype this baby. Okay, this is a clinical problem where there's an intervention. There should be non-clinical interventions beforehand, like raising the head of the bed and doing all the other general pediatric things we should do. But if that fails and we're forced to use a medicine, then there's only really one choice. And yeah, genetics is unnecessary. But just because I'm peeing on my own parade here, just because there are some situations where it is not relevant doesn't mean it's universally not relevant. Okay, and I think what I hope to persuade you of is that there are areas where it is now reasonably well established, and there are areas where it is working towards being incorporated into national and international guidelines, and hopefully I'll persuade you of that. Okay. Pediatrics is always a few years behind adult medicine. Well, not always, but often. So where are the adults? Because, you know, that's probably going to give us a signpost to where we're going. They are trying to implement this. So Professor Sir Munir Pir Mohammed, who you may have seen at the Downing Street presentation of the vaccine today. I'm trying to date stamp this, aren't I? Today's the day that the MHRA have approved the Pfizer, the first vaccine for COVID, just to give this, to age this talk horribly. But anyway, the same Professor Sir Munir Pir Mohammed is also one of the lead investigators on this PREPARE study, which basically is genotyping individuals to see if they have actionable pharmacogenomic variants and then actioning them. Okay, so we're not just changing their medicines based on the F1 thought it was a good idea, or the junior doctor didn't like this one, or, you know, somebody came around and walked around and tweaked it. This is saying, what genetics do you have? What medicines are you on? Are you optimized? And can we do something about it? And that's looking at a range of range of genes that are known to have considerable variation and pharmacogenomic effect. So the cytochrome P450s, and you'll see CYP2D6 is there. I should have made it red or something to highlight it. There's VKORC1, which is a very important in warfarin metabolism, and 1% of elderly people are on warfarin. There's TPMT, which I'm going to come to in a minute, which is very exciting and extrudes things like azathioprine, or its metabolized 6-methoxypurine from cells and prevents buildup of toxic levels, and so on and so on. So they're actually doing this now, and there are nearly 7,000 patients recruited to this study as of last month when I checked last. Okay, but this brings us to a separate pediatric issue, which is that diseases in children, even if they look similar, I will argue till I'm blue in the face, they're not necessarily the same. If that man on the left comes in and says he's got asthma, and the wheezing minor, I refuse to believe that he's, it would take a lot to persuade me that he's the same as the small boy on the right who, when the weather turns cold, goes outside and has a bit of a wheezy do. Okay? And just for Professor Sinner, I scoured the internet to find a picture of a child being given an inhaler through a spacer because he cares about that. So anyway, the diseases are not the same as adults. We have some additional pediatric issues. Generally speaking, pediatricians are conservative with a small c. We don't push the boat out and try new drugs just because they're available. We work out what we think works and we stick to it. So we generally have less drugs to choose from per condition than in adult medicine. If you think about antihypertensives, you know, there are 1,001 for adult medicine, there are very few that are used in paediatrics. And that's a general trend across a lot of medicines. Okay? We're fortunate in that our population are generally healthy. Okay, so we have smaller cohorts to investigate in the first place. And if we go back to the very first slide and the molecular genetics, our small cohorts are getting subdivided into even smaller cohorts as we understand the molecular pathology of chronic kidney disease or leukemia or whatever it might be. We end up with smaller and smaller groups that we're trying to understand the medicine's efficacy and toxicity in. For older drugs, they may have come through in the era before the regulation, the European and US regulations, that mean that there was no requirement or incentive on companies to actually undertake paediatric research. So there are a host of drugs that are used commonly, from steroids to aminophylline to all kinds of older drugs, phenytoin, where the evidence underpinning their use is a subject for a completely other talk, probably. We've got developmental changes. So not just things like the ontogeny of enzymes, but the fact that your tolerance of risk will vary wildly across childhood. Your body fat distribution will vary wildly across childhood. Your size will vary massively across childhood. Your glomerular filtration rate will vary massively in the first year of your life, and so on, and so on, and so on. So there are lots of nuances within paediatrics that I think make it particularly interesting. And as a inhabitant of Britain in the 21st century, we are seeing more and more obese children. And given that drugs tend to be either hydrophilic and will stay in your fluid compartment, or lipophilic, and tend to be dosed in milligrams per kilogram in many cases, if you have a lipophilic drug, then you may, you will increase the dose, but how much of it gets to the bit you need is questionable. If you have a hydrophilic drug, then you risk overdosing the patient because the drug stays in the vascular system or the body fluid compartment, which doesn't increase at the same rate as the metabolically inactive fat components, but you increase the dose in milligrams per kilogram. So there's all sorts of dosing issues to go with it as well. And that's before we even get to issues about formulation. And I think this is crystallized in looking at warfarin pharmacogenomics. So in adults, there is a paper on the left here, a single paper from the New England Journal, so high quality randomized controlled trial from the International Warfarin Consortium, that looked at dosing patients using pharmacogenetic data. And it was a really important study. That issue of the New England Journal actually had two separate warfarin studies in it, which had slightly contradictory results. But that's an adult warfarin talk, not this one. But in that study, they recruited 4,043 patients in the first stage and then validated their algorithm with a further 1,000 patients. Okay, the right side, the table there, shows every published pediatric warfarin study in pharmacogenetics I can find and the number of patients. And I think, do I have the number? There's approximately 660 patients in total in every pediatric warfarin study on pharmacogenomics ever published. Okay, we're smaller than one validation cohort in one study published once in adults. So that I think to me really highlights the fact that we can struggle with our population size in terms of it. And that's important in genetic research because some of the methodologies require as many patients as you can because you have to correct for an awful lot of multiple testing. Okay. An advantage of pediatrics is that these are UK figures, so they're about 15% of the UK population. They only use about 5% of the medicines. That's outpatient prescriptions, not inpatient prescriptions. I'm sure for hospital-based staff listening to this, it feels like more, but it's honestly not. And the good thing is that they're less ill. So again, there are exceptions, but on the whole, your average five-year-old is a lot healthier with a lot less medicines and a lot less illnesses than an average 85-year-old. And the second thing that's really good about paediatrics is they're altruistic. This is a lovely study from the Nottingham group who looked at a group of children in clinics and what their opinions on paediatric trials were. Now, they're not, you know, your child in the street because they weren't recruited in a shopping centre. But these children, the findings were very much that they understood that it's not just about themselves getting a benefit from clinical research, but that also they can help other people. And that's a very powerful thing in paediatrics. I've just got some things appearing on my screen, which I'm just getting rid of. I don't know if you can see them, but there's usually three. No, it's fine. Okay, so children are basically our friends and wanting to help, and that's a positive in terms of our research. Okay, so what is out there? Paediatric pharmacogenomics. Well, there's an awful lot of papers on paediatrics. I searched last night, 400,000 plus. There's a reasonably large amount of pharmacogenomic papers, 25,000 or so. Less than 1,000 between, if you look at paediatrics and pharmacogenomics, pharmacogenetics, and that comes out about 0.2% of all the paediatric literature ever, which feels about right. You know, it's a fairly new area, not that well explored. I'll be honest, I was slightly disappointed, but I hoped it would be more than that. And okay, so there's research out there, it's published. Is it affecting practice? Well, there are some areas where yes, it is absolutely established in practice, but if you don't work in those areas, you won't see it. So I'm going to just flesh those out slightly. And there are areas where it's rumbling towards practice, but where there have been some, we'll call them hiccups on the way, shall we? And we'll talk through those in a second as well and see how it's going. Just checking the time. Perfect. So TPMT. TPMT is a thiopurine methyltransferase, and it is an enzyme, well, it's a transporter that shoves 6-mercaptopurine, the active version of azathioprine, out of cells. If you don't have functional TPMT, you have a buildup of 6-mercaptopurine in your cells and you get increased immunosuppression. Okay, so although the arrow points to clinical benefit, you get buildup of it in your cells and you get problems. So you get increased, so in children who are having leukemia treatment, for instance, their cells don't recover in time for the next round of chemotherapy. So they miss chemotherapy. So not only do they get more poorly because their cell counts are suppressed for longer, but they miss subsequent rounds of chemotherapy, so they get less effective treatment. And they have increased rates of secondary cancers. So they have increased rates of other hematological malignancies, but also of brain tumors. So there are problems if you have TPMT deficiency and you're receiving azathioprine or 6-mercaptopurine. This is a population distribution of the standard population, and the nomenclature is very similar to CYP2D6. So this is for TPMT. Most people are green. By the way, I agree with the colouring of this chart, unlike the previous people chart. So most people are green. They are the star one variant. They work, or called wild type in this, WT. Okay, most people have two wild types and they have a nice functioning level of TPMT and all is hunky-dory. A small number of people have one of the variants, star 2, star 3A or star 3C. If you have one variant in this figure, you're blue and you have a bit of activity. If you have no working variants, you have very little activity, and they're the MM. M is for mutant. That's another terminology issue. So wild type is what most people have. Polymorphism represents a variant that is not the most common, and mutants tend to be less than 1%. Okay, so if you take your three groups now, and it's the same colours as before, green for wild type, blue for heterozygotes who are wild type and non-functional, and red is for two copies of non-functional, give them the same dose, that's the first chart, then they can't clear it from their cells as quickly. So the poor old red group have massively more exposure because they can't get rid of it. And hence, if you look at the Kaplan-Meier chart on the right, very quickly, they all get toxicity. You know, it goes up to one very rapidly. If you individualize dosing like you do in gastroenterology for inflammatory bowel disease or for pediatric leukemia, then you can equalize the exposure and you can equalize the toxicity rates among the population. You can't reduce them to zero. No drug is ever completely safe. No drug is ever 100% effective. But you can massively shift the curve so that you're maximizing the benefit and minimizing the risk for individuals. And that's what this is all about. Okay, so for that's an example where it's in practice, it's all working. What about areas where it's not yet in practice, but it might be? Well, I'm going to talk about asthma for this because it's common and there are multiple drugs, and I think it's a really nice example of where pharmacogenetics and pharmacogenomics could impact practice, even if it isn't quite there yet. So asthma does lots of drugs, okay? you can have multiple different inhalers, you can have combination inhalers, you can have steroids, you can have leukotriene receptor antagonists, you can have your theophyllins. For the most severe, there are biologic therapies available. There's a raft of medicines going. And people have noted over the years that some people respond to some medicines, some people don't. And now there are over 50 pharmacogenomic studies in asthma. But there is still not a single pharmacogenomic polymorphism in international guidelines like GINA or the BTS sign guidelines that are used in the UK to guide practice. And the reason for that is because people do their study and they find something. But when the next person comes along and tries to repeat their study, they don't find it. They find something different. In some cases, they found completely opposite results that made no sense. And that's caused a real headache, because is that because the population sizes were too small? Is that because the methodology was wrong? Were they measuring the wrong endpoints? Okay, so if you can't replicate it, it probably isn't true. Okay, if you can't get enough sick people into your studies, then you can't generate the proof that you need. Okay, are they measuring the right outcomes, and are they focusing too much on it? Efficacy. And the fact I'm asking the question probably leads you to the answer for that one, but we'll go through this step at a time. Okay. If you take all the pharmacogenomic studies that look at short-acting beta-2 agonists, okay, there was a concerns that if you use short-acting beta-2 agonists, then you will actually worsen your long-term asthma control over time. And is this true of all people? A lot of studies have tried to look at this effect in terms of how well do they work when you squirt them in, because there are polymorphisms within your beta-2 adrenal receptor, okay, that might, in principle, make it respond differently in it between individuals to the same molecule, salbutamol or albutamol, okay? Unfortunately, I think a lot of the outcomes used here don't marry up with core outcome sets for pediatric asthma. So a lot of work has been put in looking at what it is that patients, clinicians and parents want in research studies from asthma. Now, this was published in 2008, I think, so I can forgive the ones on the left because they looked at FEV1 and it was before the core outcomes had existed. But there still continue to be studies published that look at measures that won't change how you look after a child with asthma. FEV1 is easy to measure. That doesn't mean it's the right thing to measure, and it doesn't mean it tells you how ill the child is. For most children with asthma, their FEV1 is completely normal until they're having an asthma attack, and then it's terrible, and then you treat their asthma attack and it goes back to normal. Okay? And giving them albuterol won't change that if they're not having an asthma attack. And inducing an asthma attack is either unpleasant, unnecessary, or is going to be done in an artificial way that isn't the same as when they're experiencing their symptoms. So there's genuine questions, and this is just one example about what outcomes have been used in these studies. The other point I think we should raise is that an awful lot of the pharmacogenomic research has gone into looking at, how do we maximize the benefits of these drugs? Okay, how can we get the most number of people better? And if we think about asthma, reduce the wheeze the fastest, reduce the number of exacerbations of asthma that the child has per month, per year, whatever. And very, very few studies have looked at how do we minimize the risk associated with these therapies. And these risks are starting to bubble under the surface and be more apparent. There's a lot of chatter around about the neuropsychiatric effects of leukotriene receptor antagonists. The side effects of steroids are very well described. How do you choose between them? Are there individuals who are more risk than one than the other? So I think it's to the detriment of what's gone on that one has been focused on rather than the other. Okay, this is just a list of steroid side effects. If you really don't know them, then you can look back at the talk, but they're not, there are some that are, unpleasant, but not too bad, a bit of oral candida, we can treat that. There are some that are potentially life-threatening, hypertension, HPA axis suppression, pancreatitis. So there are lots of things that can cause problems here. How many studies out of that 50 have looked at steroids? Answer, a lot. How many studies out of the 50 pharmacogenomic studies have looked at the harm of steroids? 3. How many of the studies that have looked at the harms of steroids within within asthma and have been replicated. So actually somebody else has managed to repeat what they've done too. So there has been a genuine lack of looking at this sort of the harms. But, and I'm going to end on a positive here, actually, people have wised up to all this. Our numbers are low. We need to team up and work together. We need consortia. And the one in asthma, for instance, is called the Pharmacogenomics in Childhood Asthma Consortia, PICA. They've managed to amass more than 20 studies working together to pool genomic data. The genomic data is still owned by each study team, so there isn't a loss of, you know, investigator ownership of the data, but it does allow you to produce big cohorts and to meta-analyze, removes those issues of recruitment. By having centralized quality procedures, we can make sure everybody does the best work at the best quality and we get results. Okay, this is a forest plot from one of their last papers looking at whether a particular polymorphism in the beta 2 adrenal receptor was associated with increased exacerbations when you have a when you take a long acting beta 2 agonist like salmeterol. Okay, now individually, there's only two of those studies that showed a significant worsening, that showed increasing exacerbations with this polymorphism with a LABA, and they were very small studies. Okay, you can see from the weighting and the size of the box. But now, the fact that we can combine five studies, the fact that we've got probably nearly 800 patients in that cohort, suddenly we can start to get meaningful forest plots with significances that fall, you know, that don't cross unity, and we can start to look at whether clinical implementation is a good idea. And they're coming. And this group has also helped drive forward work like, hang on, there's a lot of drugs in asthma. What side effects are we most worried about? Going forward, if you remember this consortium, what side effects should you be putting in to measure as well as your benefits? So we understand the risks and benefits better, and we can incorporate those data in the studies going forwards. So I hope I persuaded you that genes can affect how medicines work in children and adults, if you care about adults, that you can either make drugs more or less effective or change your risk to an adverse drug reaction, that there's a lot of science behind this and our understanding of the science is improving all the time. We're not as advanced as adults in terms of the implementation, but we are moving in the right direction. And many of the issues that have caused pediatrics to lag behind are being addressed through not just individual researchers and, you know, individual units, but international collaboration and consortia, bringing the data together, driving up quality, and making sure that we actually answer the questions in a powerful and meaningful way. Excellent. Thank you very much. And any questions?
Thank you very much, Ron, for that fascinating talk. You made a very complex topic look so easy, actually. So thank you so much. I really enjoyed it, and I'm sure everyone enjoyed it as well. I got a question. I know you sort of touched on the lack of evidence and research in this area, especially in pediatrics. Do you see any other major challenges in implementing pharmacogenomics in pediatrics?
Well, there's two main challenges I see beyond the ones I spelled out here. One is an equity challenge. So it's very easy in a well-funded health system to say, I'm going to send up a genetic test for this child. But that's not true across a single country, and it's certainly not true on an international scale. So there's a real danger that pharmacogenomic research concentrates on populations who can whose health services can afford to pay for the tests. And that does worry me, that what we're doing is entrenching inequality in access to healthcare through doing this. And that's, again, where international consortia, I think, have been very useful, because while there may not be a majority of people in many studies, maybe residents of the UK or North America or mainland Europe, within that you'll have a range of ethnicities, and within the range of ethnicities, if you're pooling data, you can start to look for patterns amongst different groups, and that I think will help minimize the threat of inequality. So that's one threat I see. The other one is just the ever-changing landscape of medicines. I mean, you've got to keep up with the medicines that are being used commonly and are out there. Now, in pediatrics, we don't, like I say, we're conservative with a small c, But drugs do change, and you know, we don't prescribe aspirin anymore. If we'd done a load of pharmacogenomics of aspirin, it would all be redundant. So we have to be a bit careful and choose our targets carefully, I think.
Sure. And I presume, like in some fields like oncology or immunotherapy, this is a little bit more advanced. Am I right in thinking about this?
So there are. So there's a group, for instance, in the UK, Professor Veal, who's a pharmacokinetic and pharmacogenomic expert. He analyzes samples from kids with cancer in Newcastle, and they can personalize doses of therapy based on what your PK levels are. So yes, there are areas where it is embedded and run very professionally, but that is very much the exception, not the rule.
Sure. And I mean, you do think there'll be cost barriers to it eventually when we get to the stage of implementing and all that, like, and you have more evidence, or will it be more cost effective eventually when we use this pharmacogenomics?
So that's a really interesting question. And do you know what? Nobody's actually asked families and what they want, because if you've got cancer, it's likely to be cost effective because you're already getting a massively expensive therapy, you know, massive inpatient costs, massive drug costs, massive all sorts of things. So actually this is a tiny change, and if you're improving outcomes, great. But what about, and I'm going to go back to asthma, you know, 1 in 11 children is diagnosed with asthma. Implementing genetic testing in that cohort massively increases the costs of asthma therapy because it's such a big population. But who should own the data? What do people think? When should it be done? At what level of severity? And so there are research projects going on trying to understand how data that's quite personal and can run beyond the disease you're looking at, how acceptable that is to children and families, using asthma as the exemplar.
Great, thank you so much. One last question, probably a naive question from me. Is it something that could be implemented as part of the newborn screening? This is probably thinking beyond.
The issue there is that, so I hesitate because I think if you have a problem, an illness, and there is a potential treatment to make it better, then there is a potential benefit. When you're born, most kids who are born don't have any inherent illnesses, and therefore the potential benefit is limited. The potential risks are legion. What if you identify that they're prone to get Alzheimer's disease? Do they really care? What if you identify that their dad isn't their dad? My God, who wants to tell them that? Yeah, there's all sorts of questions around the data, the application of the data, and its cross relevance beyond just drugs into other areas of their lives. So within newborn screening, I hesitate, but I think on the other hand, if you have a test done for a reason, because your warfarin dose needs testing and you've had congenital heart disease surgery as a child, then absolutely those data should be available to other people where the polymorphisms would apply, because otherwise you repeat testing and that's unnecessary venipuncture on a child. So there's a balance somewhere.
Okay, thank you so much, Dan. I don't think we have any more questions. There are compliments coming through. Great talk. Thank you, Dan. So that's very good talk, and absolutely fascinating topic. And it's looks like lots of development to come through in the next few years. So thank you so much for your time today. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much.
And then we will join back again 4 o'clock next week. You get time for another session. One of our ED colleagues is going to talk on an important topic on pain management in the emergency department. So see you all then. Thank you so much. Thanks.